Hello, lovely people. I hope you're all keeping well, and a very warm welcome to another Mixed Media Lavinia Stamps tutorial with me, Lisa Taggart. I'm calling this one Spellbound, and I'm very lucky to be using some of the new release stamps. I've had enormous fun creating this magical scene full of hocus pocus for you today. So we're beginning off with our A4 sheet of multifarious card, and I'm taking the sprays and I'm really aiming just to spray on the top half of the sheet and mainly towards the top in a sort of arch shape, if you can manage it. And then gradually I'm creating lighter colours in the centre. Moved on there to the Mysticals for some extra colour. Now the yellow. And for murkiness, I'm using Salvage Patina. It's always good in the mix. And finally some white to brighten it up. And it looks like a great ink sandwich full of loveliness. So let's see what we get. And there we are. It's murky enough, so just mop it down slightly, and I think the one I have in my hand will do. It's now dry and I've trimmed it down to 8.5 by 7.5 inches, and we're going to first of all mark out the position of our bell jar. And what I wanted to do was to keep the light yellow in the center, because that's going to be the cauldron fire. And I'm just taking a pencil, first of all, just to mark it in and get that down so we know where the composition is going to begin. And what I'm going to do now is I'm going to build up the outside, and I'm starting off with the Fantasia colour, which is a lovely dark purple. And I'm just going to lightly do around the edges and the top half of the card. There we are. Moving on then to the bluebell, I'm going to do a fine layer just in the inside of the purple, on the same place, just in the inside. And finally, we've got our Kitsch Flamingo in the Distress Oxide. And this is for pure murkiness, and this is what I love using the oxides for, to add a bit of atmosphere. And I'm just going all the way around in circular motions with my large stencil brush, blending that in to the other layers, just particularly around the bell jar. And there you are, it's all blended. Finally then, for some dark denim and the medium size brush, I've gone round the very edge just to darken that down, and this draws your eye in. Now for the stamping, and I'm going to remove the first little book, and I'm going to stamp this twice underneath the bell jar, and the idea is that the jar is going to be balancing on the books, just like that. I'm also going to be adding some hocus pocus jars. So I'm going to put down a couple at the front. I'm going to mask those off with the fluid. And there we are. It's now dry. And then stamp another layer of jars and mask those as well. And then finally, the two at the back. Now that it's all masked, I'm going to stamp the trees in the background, and you'll see I'm taking off the bottom of the trunk because I want them to the trunk to bend into the mist, just like that. I'm going to stamp them first and second generation ink, and you can see I've stamped off the tree first of all before I placed it down, so it looks as if it's in the background. I'm also stamping them at different heights, and all the while remembering to remove the bottom of the trunk so that it blends into the misty background. And that's a final one at the top there. So there you go. Now I'm going to paint the foreground using my water reactive elements. And this is a handy way to use the elements like watercolour. And I've got my brush there, and because all of the stamping up in the foreground has been masked with the blue masking fluid, you can just lightly paint over the background and then remove the bell jar mask. And just to lighten that up a wee bit, and again going back to the murkiness, you're going to listen to me use that word a lot, just adding in some mistiness there in the foreground, and then going over some of the edges and underneath the jars and the books to add shadow with the dark denim pad. And in a wee minute, I'm going to lift again the bell jar mask. Not quite there yet. Here we go. And set that down so that I can add some darker, deeper shadow underneath the bell jar. Because these things are masked, it's a handy way to add in all the shadow. And now I'm using the mask again to pencil out the plinth. And that is a double plinth, I think, with this design. So adding that in on pencil so I know where I am. Also taking the bottom of the sticker stencil, to give me an idea of the shape of where the focal images are going to be stamped. And I've taken then the masking sheet and cut out the shape of the plinth, and I'm putting that down. Next up, we're using some more VersaFine Claire. Now, I did pull out this pink colour, and it didn't really do very much, so you could well do without it and just stick to the Very Peri. And I'm just adding in some dark shadow there to the bottom. So that would do on its own if you want to just use that. And then I thought I would put my stencil mask back on again and delineate the edges a little bit better, so we can see how that looks. And it's really a case of gradually building the whole thing up. And I'm going to go round the whole stencil all the way around the outside and see how that looks. Just like that. And next up again, I'm adding in the Distress Oxide again to give the impression of murkiness towards the top. Taking the small stencil brush now, going back to the Very Peri in VersaFine Claire and going round the edge. And now I want to sort of mark out the background a little bit by using this pale peachy colour, which tones in, I think, very well with the oranges and the yellows that are used. And I really love using the oxides for creating mistiness. And I'm back then to the Salvage Patina, and I've masked it all off with copy paper, and I'm giving a couple of sprays of that. And what this does, you'll see when I remove the mask, is it really does create like a sort of misty glass effect, which we'll build on. Now for the moon, and I've taken the medium size, I think this is, and I'm going to mark that out first of all with the stencil. And then now what I'm doing is, this is a technique I use to create my moons. You don't have to do it this way. You could, of course, use your Lavinia Stamps moon stamp if you have that. I don't have that. But what I do is I add in very basic colours on the moon, on top of the moon. And what I'm doing is trying to sort of mimic, I suppose, the colours in the rest of the picture, just for colour balance. And in terms of the moon shape, it's pretty much a sideways sort of off-center face, a smiley face, and it looks a bit like that. And I'll go back to that in a little minute, but first of all, now that that's in place, I want to do the stamping of the main focal images in the picture, and I'm going to stamp out the cauldron, the witch, and the cat. And there we go. Now that that's in place, I can do some background trees. I'm masking off the side there, and you could use your stencil mask, but at this stage I just couldn't be bothered, which I'm living dangerously as usual. So adding in the trees, and you can increase the height of them as well by masking off the bottom, and there we are, they're there on both sides. Now I'm going back to the moon, and part of my technique, as I say, is wait for the inks to dry, and you can dry them off with a heat gun, and then you cover the whole thing in white pastel. I'm using my pan pastel, but you can of course use your pastel pencils or pastel sticks. And now I'm taking a juicy white gel pen and just doing the edge of the moon, so it looks a bit like that. And now for the fun part, I'm going to add in my lopsided happy face by erasing the pan pastel using this battery operated eraser. Now I say it's fun because it bounces around a lot and you have to really hold it quite firmly, but once you get used to it, it's a great thing to use, and it's very effective because it has a precision eraser. And so it is like a little face with a few extra dots added in for good measure. And then I take my finger and blend it out and then add in some extra pastel where I think it needs it, just to brighten it up. And you can also use your pastel pencils to add in a little bit of colour to the dark areas as well. And I think I did that there off camera. So moving on then to the little scene in the centre, taking out my pastel pencils, and I've got like a sort of yellowy greeny colour just to repeat the colours of the fieriness above from the centre, adding some shadows with a sort of a dark bluey purple, like a dark periwinkle, taking that underneath the little cat, and some dark pencil as well, just to add in some shadows here and there, and just wherever you fancy really, repeating the colours in the background, because of course they'll reflect into the centre. And now what I'm doing is I'm taking my pastel pencils and adding in some deeper colours, again reflecting what the colours in the rest of the picture. And what this does is it draws your eye in then to the center part above the cauldron, and it makes the yellow look a little bit brighter. And then taking the sort of a yellowy greeny color pencil, I mean yellow would do as well, and starting to add some fire, or I don't know what you'd call it, some smokiness coming out of it. Obviously it's magic and it can look whatever way you want, but it's just as a backdrop to the lovely stamp that I'm, or both stamps that I'm going to use next. And so it's just making it look a bit crazy, a bit witchy, putting in the colours that you fancy, just little squiggles, a bit like that. And finally some red as well for good measure. And some white to brighten it up a little bit, and then I think I blend that in as well. So next up I'm adding the cauldron bubbles using Fantasia. And this is a beautiful, delicate little stamp, and it's so handy. And just putting those around the bout. And then this beautiful smoky stamp shape, which was going to be quite versatile and used for all sorts of things. Now, what I did was I decided to colour in the bubbles, and I've used a green Posca pen along with my black fine liner for some definition, and then a white highlight. And then I took my orange Posca and just added little dots of orange round about. And then took my mint colour pastel pencil, added some shadow, some highlight, and then some yellow highlight as well along the edges of the little cat, and did some squiggly yellow lines to indicate some extra smoke. Now, this is where I'm going to, now that the scene's been done, I'm going to add some extra dimension to the jar and make it look a little bit more 3D. And I'm using my finest, smallest stencil brush for this. And I'm following the lines of the shape of the jar and going slightly in a bit from the outside, and drawing that all the way down and repeating that just at the bottom on the right hand side, so far as the dark part is concerned. And then instead of having the line going the whole way up the dark line, I'm making the side bright, Now, I wasn't happy with the pastel pencil on its own, so I reached for my pan pastel and brightened that up a bit, and all the while blending it out. And I just wanted it to come around the top, but not the whole way down the side, just blending it in with the darkness at the top. And then at this stage, I thought it would be best to use the actual shape of the stencil to make it a clean line. And I extended that down the side as well. And you'll see there it is when it's finished. And then finally added some white gel pen highlights around parts of the edge, not around the whole edge. So that's that done, and time to add some bats. And there we are, and it sort of draws the two pictures, the background and what's in the jar, together. Now at this stage, it's time to remove the little masking sheet that I put on the plinth, and I'm going to colour that in. And I thought, rather than just doing brown wood sort of tones, that in keeping with what I've been doing so far, I would balance the picture by using very similar colours and reflect those in the base as well. So I've taken a blue, a brown, a sort of a murky pink and a violet colour. And I'm basically going to mix all those together to see what I get, making the centre the lightest part. And of course, when you mix brown and blue, you'll get a very sort of dark, almost a black colour. So that's what's happened there at the sides. I want to also keep the very edges clear if possible, keep those light. And so I just mix the Zig Clean Colour markers together. Now, I do, the surface of this part in terms of the card is a little bit rough because of the residue that was left either from the stencil, the masking sheet, or my masking fluid. And I notice as I colour that there's a couple of little bubbles here and there, and I think I might have flicked some masking fluid. They're showing up now. But I'm not put off by that, because I can fix that. I'll rub it a wee bit, and then I do have a technique for blending all of this in a minute or two. So dried that off, and then I've taken my white gel pen and put that around the bottom. And this is the important part. I've taken a flesh colour pastel pencil and gone over the top of that, and really pared that colour back by adding some lines and blending it in, and it looks a little bit more realistic now. So now I'm going to remove the masking gum from the elements of the front, and there it's gone. And we're going to do some colouring. Starting off with the potion bottles, what I wanted was to create the idea of some bubbling potions and some witchiness, and just to add to the story. So I'm keeping the top half light and making the bottom more dense where the liquid is, and then thinking of shadows in the glass, and trying to straighten up that line across the centre. And then this is a great colour I did find for this picture. It's a fluorescent yellow from the larger set of the Zig Clean colour markers, and it brightened everything up so well. And as you know, I love to put little dots in everything, so this was my chance to start putting in little details of bubbling potion. And I took different gel pens and whatever I had to hand, basically. Also remembering to add the highlights around the little glass jars, just like something like that. You could, of course, use the bubble stamp, and wish I had done that. But I think I've got carried away with my colouring in. Now I'm just using the brown, and then this is the blender brush from the set, just to blend that out, and then again adding some light highlights and something like that. Now moving on to the books. Again, this is just lines what I wanted to do as well is just to, by hand, add in the little edge of the book from the top that wasn't stamped, to give the impression that it's still there. And just taking the similar colours and adding those to the books to draw the colour composition together, and just blending everything into each other, and all the while mixing the main colours together, really, just to see what happens. And I do love the combination of greens and violets and blues as well. So I'm going to carry on colouring in and then come back. And that's most of them done. And I thought I would keep this one just to show you that you don't have to do them all the same colour. And I also discovered how to make the bubbles glow. So I'll show you that as well. So this one obviously is going to be lilacs and blues, and just blend. The good thing about the markers is that they really blend so well together, and you just keep going until you get the desired effect, really. And now I think I'm going to add, you know, just blending that in, and then I'm going to add some texture for the potion. And what I discovered was, if I used my white gel pen and used that for the highlights as well, and if I took the blender brush, that's a good way to blend the white gel pen, which I discovered in this project, so I might use that again. But if you then put the fluorescent colour over the top, it just makes them glow. So that was fun, and I ended up putting that in quite a lot of places, adding extra highlights with Posca pen, and that's about it. And now here's the trick to make the books look a bit more pared back in terms of colour, is take what's left on your brush from the Distress Oxide and just brush it over the top. Now I'm adding some extra smoke coming from the bubbling bottles of spells and horrible mixtures, and basically adding in the fluorescent colour again because I got a little bit obsessed. And I think I finished that off by then adding some white pastel pencil just for extra dimension. And there you are. What fun! So that's more or less it coloured in, and that's the picture more or less complete, apart from adding in some stars just freehand, again using my white gel pen, and of course some obligatory sparkle using waterfall in diamond stickles. I added that in the little jars and also in the bubbling cauldron. It's not quite dry yet, so it doesn't sparkle as much under the camera as it does when it's dry, but you can see it a little bit. There we are, the whole scene complete. And it's amazing what you can develop from an initial ink spray background with the traditional ink sandwich. So I hope you enjoyed following along with my creative process this week, and it's given you some ideas for your own projects. But of course, until next time, take very good care of yourselves, and thank you so much for watching.